This video tutorial is an introduction to some of the new features in the OWASP Zed Attack Proxy version 2.0.0. My name is Simon Bennett and I'm the ZAP project lead. There are lots of new features, so I'm just going to cover them at a very high level. Future videos will focus on individual features in more depth. I'm going to assume you're already familiar with ZAP. If not, it's worth having a look at the ZAP homepage and maybe some of the training videos we've already recorded. And it's worth noting this release does require Java 7, so make sure you have that installed. So this is what you'll see when you now start ZAP. The most obvious difference is that we've now got a new Quick Start tab. This allows you to perform a very quick test of a web application. Just type in the target URL and press the attack button. So this runs a spider, and then runs the active scanner, and finally switches to the Alerts tab to show you what it's found. This is a nice and quick way to scan an application, but it does have significant limitations. Firstly, we'll not be able to authenticate, so we'll miss any content that is protected via a login page. Secondly, while the spider has been significantly improved, it is still not as effective as exploring an application manually or using regression tests. One of the biggest changes is the way extensions or add-ons are managed. If you click the Manage Add-ons button on the toolbar, then you'll be presented with this dialog. This shows the add-ons you have installed and allows you to check for any updates. Note that the active and passive scan rules are add-ons. This means you can be alerted when they're updated and even choose to have them automatically installed via the options. Once you've done a check for updates, then you'll be able to see the add-ons that are available from the ZAP marketplace. If you hover over any of these add-ons, you'll see more information. Add-ons are marked as alpha for add-ons that are in an early stage of development, beta for those who have been reviewed and passed a standard set of criteria, and release for those who have been reviewed and thoroughly tested. We've actually moved some of the functionality that was built into previous versions of ZAP into add-ons, such as the port scanner and the FuzzDB files. So if you want to install an add-on like the port scanner, then just check the box and click the Install Selected button. As you'll see, the add-on is downloaded and installed dynamically, so you don't even need to restart ZAP. As you'll hopefully be aware, we have lots of help files which you can access using the F1 key or the new Help button on the right of the toolbar. All beta and release quality add-ons will provide help files which will be dynamically added to the standard help and can be found under the add-ons section in the tree. You've already briefly seen the spider when I ran the quick start attack. The spider has been completely rewritten as part of the Google Summer of Code, and is much faster and finds many more links than the old one. We also have a new Ajax spider. This spider uses CrawlJax and Selenium to drive a browser to explore your application. It's slower than the other spider, but much more effective exploring apps that make heavy use of JavaScript. So if you're testing an Ajax-based app, then this may well be the best option. And the third Google Summer of Code project from last year added support for WebSockets. As you can see, if you visit a site that uses WebSockets, then ZAP will show you all of the messages. You can even set breakpoints, change the messages, and fuzz them as well. As far as I know, ZAP currently has the best support for WebSockets of any security tool, commercial or open source. Another feature that was added when the spider was rewritten is support for HTTP sessions. ZAP keeps a track of all your sessions and allows you to switch between them. So as you can see here, I've currently got one session. If I log in as this user, then you can see that I'm staying logged in. I can then rename this session to help me keep track of them. I can also now start a new session. When I switch back to the browser, you'll see that I'm now no longer logged in. But both of these sessions are still valid, and I can switch between them using ZAP from the same browser. As you can see, I'm logged back in now. I'll switch back to the other session, and I'll no longer be logged in. If you right-click a node on the tree, then you'll see an option to add the node to a context. Contexts are actually just a set of URL regexes that define which URLs are to be included and excluded. You could have as many contexts as you like, but the intention is they should represent an application. You can then associate more information with them, as I'll show you later. You can rename them, and by default they are added to the scope. As you'll see, all of the nodes that are part of the scope now have a target icon on them. So the scope defines a set of applications you are currently testing, and you can change which contexts make up the scope at any time. The scope is used in various places in ZAP, for example in the History tab. You can click on the button on the far left to just show requests in scope. One of the other ways the scope is used is when you change mode. ZAP has three modes which are set in the main toolbar. Safe mode prevents you from doing anything with ZAP that could be considered an attack. So this is useful when you want to use ZAP to have a look at an application that you don't have permission to test. Standard mode, on the other hand, lets you do anything you want to any site. And protected mode allows you to track anything that is in scope and won't let you do anything to URLs that are out of scope. Once you have defined a context, you can do things like specify how to authenticate to it. So in this case, I'm going to look at the budget store and find the login request. And if I right-click on it, then I can flag it as the login request for budget. I can also have a look at the response and find a string which indicates that I've successfully logged in. If I highlight that string, right-click it, then I can flag it as a context logged in indicator. So this allows ZAP to tell if a user is logged in and how to re-authenticate. There is now an option enabled on the toolbar which will automatically re-authenticate you when you're performing an active scan. This can be useful when using the UI, but really comes into its own when using the API. In this release, the REST API has been significantly extended. If you click on the Tools Browse API menu, then you can browse and use the API from your browser. Note that you must be proxying through ZAP and have the API enabled in the options. You can call the API directly. We also have Java and Python clients. We'll be happy to work with you if you'd like clients in other languages. ZAP now has two controls which allow you to tune the active scanner further. These are the alert threshold, which allows you to decide whether you want more or less potential issues reported, and the attack strength, which controls how many attacks will perform, and therefore how long the scan will take. So that was a quick introduction to the main features we've added in 2.0.0. It's worth noting there are a lot of other changes that are not so obvious. For example, the active and passive scan rules have been improved so they find more issues and report less false positives. And ZAP is faster and uses much less memory than before. Please let us know what you think of this release via the user group, email or Twitter. And to download the latest ZAP release and find more information about it, then go to the ZAP homepage.